So the story here actually starts about 90 million years ago, before the dinosaurs even died out. This is with the emergence of the first primates, these arboreal, very primitive types of monkeys. But what was important about the emergence of primates was a different kind of brain. And with most animals, you get a bigger body, you get a bigger brain. Bigger brain operates the bigger body, right? So you get twice as big of an animal, twice as big of a brain. But a better measure of intelligence isn't brain size, but neuron count. And so you don't really need twice as much brain power to operate twice as big of a body. So the neuronal density doesn't keep up with that increase in brain size. So you get a rodent that's four times as big, you get a brain that's four times as big, but only about twice as many neurons. So the neuronal density doesn't keep up, you don't get a more intelligent rodent, so you get a bigger rodent. That changed with the early emergence of primates. For whatever reason, we don't know why, as you get a bigger monkey, you get a bigger brain, and the neuronal density stays very consistent. Twice as big a monkey, twice as big a brain, twice as many neurons. And what we've learned as we look at this development of primate brains, that our brains follow very much the same pattern. In fact, our brain to body weight proportion is the same as most monkeys around today and those early primitive monkeys. And then all it took to get an ape as intelligent as we are is to just get a bigger monkey. Bigger monkey is smarter monkey. It really was just that simple. Although it gets a little more complicated over the last 20 million years. We get the emergence of the great apes. So we know of over 100 species of great apes. Didn't even know some of the species of great ape. Five that are still alive today. Gorilla?
All right, animal expert. It's you.
Gorilla? What else we got? Five great apes.
Five great apes.
Chimpanzee, you're absolutely right.
Yeah. Orangutan.
Orangutan, got it.
Lemur.
One that's tough, this is a bonobo. I'm called a bonobo and chimp, so that's a little bit tougher. The fifth one is the easiest, though.
Chimpanzees.
Us.
Oh, man.
We are the fifth great ape. So we're one of five great apes still alive today, which is just big apes, right? That's pretty, what's that mean? But this is weird. Remember I mentioned that all you need to get a smart monkey is a bigger monkey? So why aren't gorillas smarter than us? Gorillas are bigger than us. We're bigger. Well, so why are they out of proportion? So we are basically big monkeys. We have the same proportion as monkeys. Gorillas have brains that are smaller in their proportions. They have brains about half our size, even though their body is up to twice our size. Turns out that the great apes have brains that are shrunken out of proportion because brains are incredibly expensive to feed. They take a lot of calories. Our brain costs about 500 calories a day. Just sitting around watching TV.
Yep.
That's one of our most expensive organs, just a little bit, our liver is just a little more expensive, but everybody has to have a liver. So, gorillas can only feed about 9 hours a day on raw plant material. They can't feed a brain our size, so they're pushing the limit of what they can feed. So, the big question of during human evolution is, how did we resume those early primate proportions? How are we able to feed our big brain, okay? So how long is this story? So we can use DNA just to look at chimpanzees, our closest relatives, and us. And we last shared a common ancestor about 6 to 8 million years ago. Now, if you look at fossils that are about 5 million years old, it's really hard to tell without any DNA what lineage that falls in. Is it closer related to a chimp or closer related to us? It's really hard to say. These all look very ape-like. Really, the story of more human-like features of hominid evolution is 4 million years, the last 4 million years. Now, this is a politically interesting topic, right? The idea of our origins. And this has been so toxic. So when Darwin first published on the origin of species, he was initially pretty coy about human evolution. But he accurately predicted that Africa was the cradle of human evolution, and that was where our evolution was driven. But a lot of people didn't like that idea, and this drove one of the biggest hoaxes in scientific history called Piltdown Man. Piltdown Man was a human skull that was painted brown to look very old, and it was paired with an orangutan jaw and chimpanzee teeth that were filed down, okay? And this drove the idea that early ancestors were hunched over, that we weren't bipedal, but brain size came before bipedalism, and that England was the cradle of human evolution. Yeah, at least that's not the way it works. Also, so have you ever seen that cartoon of chimpanzee to hunched over caveman to less hunched over? Upright walking caveman, right there, you see. That's not how evolution works, this kind of gradual change.
Oh.
Different parts of our humanity evolve at different parts. So let's start with the real story, with Lucy right behind you.
Thanks, Lucy.
Reconstruction.
Yeah, amazing.
So Lucy you can already see, it's about 4 million years old, one of the class of Australopithecines, a kind of great ape, which doesn't fit that cartoon at all. She's completely bipedal. She's not hunched over, she's a completely upright walking ape. Now she has a brain about the same size as a chimpanzee. This is just another kind of old chimpanzee, another way to be a chimpanzee. Now the advantage of being bipedal clearly appears to be about efficiency of walking. She uses half as many calories as a chimpanzee walking on all fours, or even chimpanzee can't efficiently walk on its hind limbs very well because its pelvis isn't built to do that. Now, as with anything in evolution, you gain one thing, you lose another thing. Notice her bottom feet, she's lost the ability to grasp that toe. Toe has migrated to the front, she walks on a flat foot just like us. She isn't as agile as grasping tree limbs, but she is able to walk much longer distances, much more efficiently over the African savanna. Now, one early idea was that as soon as we get hominids that walk upright, they free their hands. Now they can manipulate their environment so much more effectively, that's gonna drive larger brain size. Turns out, no. For over a million years, we've seen no change in brain size whatsoever, even though she's completely upright walking. In fact, these kinds of Australopithecines, you really don't want to think of them as a transitional form. They were a very successful kind of ape up to about 70,000 years ago. And there's no reason they couldn't have survived to present day, and I like to think the human evolution story would have been much more obvious to us if we could go and find different kinds of Lucys hanging around Central Africa today. Now, she does have a slightly bigger brain than some of her ancestors might have, because she's saving energy in walking upright. You notice she's very slim in her upper body, not nearly the brawniness you see with a gorilla or a chimpanzee. She does save a little bit of energy, but the question of how we feed our big brains doesn't appear to be solved by bipedalism alone. So you can see some of her cousins over here. These are many different kinds of Australopithecine, some of these skulls. My favorite is the white skull right here in the middle. You can see on the bottom row. It's called the Bosii. It's nicknamed Nutcracker Man. This guy has really powerful, broad jaws. But he wasn't hunting meat. He was exclusively a vegan, eating the toughest reed plants in Central Africa that most other apes weren't going to be able to digest. So he's just a quiet, docile guy munching on the equivalent of bamboo, right? Quiet guy. Now, he did one thing really well. And lots of animals do that. They do one thing really well. It's called a niche, kind of an organism. They have a really narrow niche. The problem is that Africa was an incredibly dynamic environment over the last few million years. You have 100 years of drought, 100 years of wetlands, the climate was changing and massive storms. And so if you did one thing really well, it was really hard to survive a changing climate. The ones that were very successful were the jack of all trades. They could eat plants, they could eat meat, they could scavenger kill, they could eat seafood, they could do all the things we needed to do. So that's Homo habilis. Homo habilis is not featured here because this exhibit's kind of out of date. We also don't have a lot of fossils of Homo habilis, but we do have our stone tools. Homo habilis is an incredibly important linchpin in the story. This is the first species of our genus Homo. It still looks very ape-ish, a lot like Lucy, but more in its behavior it was very different. Now, tools are not as special as you might think. Birds use tools, chimps use tools. Chimps can strip off and make spears out of wood. And otters, they can use rocks. Using rocks is no big deal. However, manufacturing stone tools, this is the first of its kind. Now you can see those stone tools right here. In this lower row, these were probably made by Homo habilis. There you basically take a rock, you break it in half, and use the sharp edge. Not very sophisticated. But what it allowed them to do is break apart bone and eat the incredibly rich bone marrow. So they could scavenge a kill, the lions aren't going to eat out that bone marrow. They can break open those bones, get that rich calorie, feeds a slightly larger brain. Not much though, it's a marginally larger brain, but it's nice to see the slight improvement over the course of this development. So now we have our brand new genus, Homo, human, like us. And we take the next leap forward to about 1.5 million years ago, 2 million to 1.5 million. Go ahead and come in so you can see, with Homo erectus. Now this is Turkanaboy. Turkanaboy is one of the most well-preserved specimens of Homo erectus that we've ever found. Now block something because I want to quiz you. How old do you think Turkanaboy is? Teenager? What are we thinking? Older? Younger? What do you think? 30s? Yeah, teens to 30s. 15. So by human standards, he's just finished up puberty. He's about 16 to 18 years old. He's almost fully grown. He'll be about 6 feet tall eventually. Really? He's about 10 years old. He's actually a young kid. By our standards, in age and years, he's pretty much, he looks like a young man. The this point, which is fascinating. He's maturing much faster than we are. But as you can already tell from experience, looking very human, the striking thing is more of how long he's taking to mature. He's actually taking a very long time. Chimps become sexually mature in only a few years. Lucy was only taking a couple of years. This guy takes 10 years to become sexually mature. That's insanely long, right? So we see a lot more human features in the time in which it takes for him to develop. One thing I'll point out, check out the length of his lower leg, from heel to knee, compared to Lucy or a chimp. This guy has a long Achilles tendon. He is an efficient runner. You know, it's one thing to be bipedal, but this guy can run and run and run. This guy's a marathon runner. Very human feature. We also see the loss of body hair at about this time, is what we think. Now, what do you think would be the advantage of losing your body hair in the African savannah?
It's hot.
It's hot, right? Exactly right. It's hot. I kind of primed you there with the African savannah thing, right? Tougher question. So why don't all African animals lose their body hair? Well, same thing for all of us. What's special about these guys?
They started wearing skins when they wanted to.
Start wearing skins, a lot of good ideas. Well, so you're right about the heat. You're right about the heat. But what's unique about us is the question. All right, so I love the ideas, and I would love to hold a seminar on this. About cut to the chase. I think it's an application for hunting, which may seem pretty weird. Why would you do it? Exactly right. So I drop you guys in Central Africa. You don't have a crossbow, you don't have a shotgun, you aren't really fast, you don't have big teeth, you don't have big claws. What do you have over all of the predators there? Not speed, but efficiency of running. So you may not be able to run down a kudu. It's just too fast. But if you can keep it running, you can shed your body heat faster than it can. It's eventually going to get exhausted. You have heat stroke. And then you just walk through a killing. This is a strategy called persistence hunting, which is still used in Africa today. You can actually watch National Geographic and track some animals that use this strategy. Now, think about that. That takes a lot of strategy. It's a very difficult strategy to employ. It's probably these guys would have had to think a lot, work with their groups, and I get through more of the more obvious human features, which is his face, a much more human face, and a skull, a bulbous skull. This guy has a much bigger brain. Now, it's still closer to about two-thirds the size that we have today. But this is a big inflection point in human evolution. The brain has taken off. Why? How can we feed our big brains, whereas the gorillas couldn't, Lucy couldn't, Homo habilis couldn't? Look at how slim his face is. Slim lower jaw, as opposed to chimps, have this broad out like snout. Their jaw sticks outward. This guy doesn't have to work nearly as hard to chew his food because he's cooking every one of his meals. That is the secret. You simply have to be smart enough to be able to get fire. Then when you cook your food, you release so many more calories from meat and from plants that you can get take advantage so much more. You don't have to eat nearly as much. You can feed a giant brain. You're no longer limited really by simple calories. Also, you digest that food externally by cooking it. If you ever had to chew raw meat, or especially raw vegetables, it's very tough to do. Right? Chewing raw vegetables versus cooked vegetables, it softens. You don't need to waste as much energy digesting. It also sterilizes your food, so you don't have to waste as much energy fighting infections. Right? Okay. This all makes some sense. So we see much more human features. Also notice, with the slimming of the jaw, his face changes. You see more dramatic changes to follow. Notice his lower jaw started to drop out, flare out, and you get a prominent chin. You ever appreciated how cool it is to have a chin? What other animal has a chin? Right? That's not a thing, right? Why do we have a chin? What do you get as an advantage of your chin? What that does is it drops your tongue in your mouth, so you have much more space in your mouth. Drops your tongue, allows you to make much more sophisticated sounds with your tongue. Much more sophisticated, and sophisticated is the key. Lots of animals have language. But subtlety is another important thing. You also see the emergence of the widening of the whites of our eyes at about this time. The eye socket widens out. Now, what does that allow you to do? More white eyes. Yeah, you can tell where I'm looking, right? I can communicate with you, and you can tell very subtly. You can tell emotion very subtly, communicate subtly, silently. Perfect. These are all great things. So probably not peripheral vision, but you can tell where I'm looking by seeing the whites of my eyes and defining my iris, right? So this is the key here. So Homo erectus was incredibly successful. We see a much more human-like species. These guys would leave Africa and go as far west as Western Europe, as far east as China and Indonesia, with specimens like Peking Man, Java Man, we found all around Eurasia. Stephen would get trapped on an island of Flores in Indonesia, developing a new species called Homo floresiensis. Homo floresiensis, exactly right. So this is the 3-foot-tall version of Homo erectus, which was discovered the same year the first Lord of the Rings movie came out. So this is The Hobbit. This captured the imagination. They wanted to nickname it, or name it Homo hobbitus, but there were copyright issues. So Homo floresiensis is interesting. So he's a scaled-down version of Homo erectus, and the brain scales smaller too. But they're still manufacturing the same stone tools, probably still using fire, which is interesting, even though their brain is closer to Lucy's size. They seem to be ingrained behaviors. Floresiensis, so this is an example of island miniaturization. When animals are trapped on islands, they will often become smaller. There are island elephants that are about that tall. You don't have to travel as far, there's not as many resources on the island, and becoming miniaturized is a very easy thing for natural selection to do. So floresiensis, we've recently discovered, lived for a long time, way outlived Homo erectus, to about 70,000 years ago. And in fact, this is such recent work, there is a legend from the indigenous people of Indonesia of the Ibus, which were these short, hairy people with wide mouths and poor language. So it's nice to fantasize, maybe Homo floresiensis lived alongside Homo sapiens in Indonesia. The rumor is that they were wiped out at about the same time of European colonization. Interesting idea, right? Stay tuned to that. So this is Homo erectus. None of these guys that left Africa would be our ancestors, though. Our ancestors remain in Central Africa, so we jump forward to about 600,000 years ago. 600,000 years ago with Homo heidelbergensis. Heidelbergensis is the granddaddy of all the modern hominids. This guy and all his descendants have brains about the size of us, and really we're splitting hairs at about levels of intelligence. These guys are going to give rise to Neanderthals about 400,000 years ago, and then Homo sapiens about 100,000 to 300,000 years ago. So these are probably our closest and common ancestors. Now, we know a lot about Neanderthals being in Western Europe, the height of the Ice Age, so I'll talk about that. These guys are our cousins, not our direct ancestors, but our cousins. Now, so Neanderthals are big, stocky guys living during the height of the Ice Age. The stockiness allows you to maintain your body temperature, those cold temperatures, when you're hunting mammoths. These guys were exclusively hunting big game, mostly up close. It doesn't appear that they had projectiles, they had big, broad spears, and a lot of injuries. They probably didn't live past their 40s. Lots of broken bones, broken fingers. These are tough dudes. We also see a very big, broad nose. Now, you start to see our big human-like nose with Homo erectus. It allows you to regulate that body temperature while you're hunting. It's just assuming, right? Not just lose body hair, but breathe and really release that body heat. Neanderthals have an even bigger nose. Why would you want to cool off and shed your body heat when you're in such a cold environment?
You're still hunting.
You still want to cool off. Well, so this seems a little bit weird. One of the most dangerous things you can do in the cold is sweat. As if you sweat, if you work hard, now you're drenched in wet clothes, and you stop. So regulating body temperature is still important, and with these ambush hunters, these sprinters, it's exceptionally important so they don't get sweaty. Now we have nice specimens of Neanderthals. We can actually reproduce their voice box. So Neanderthals, we have long voice boxes about this big. It gives us our nice low-pitched radio voices. Neanderthals had shorter voice boxes, a little bit wider at the top. And with their stocky kind of musculature around their chest, some voice actors have tried to reproduce what Neanderthals would have sounded like. So we say 1, 2, 3, Neanderthals would say, kind of more staccato and higher pitched. Now, to them, we would sound all like Barry White. We would sound unusually low, you know, rumbling. So that was just normal for them. But it appears they had just as such capacity for language and speech, the same box genes that we have. Just as intelligent, like Neanderthals may have had larger brains than us. So Homo sapiens emerged over the course of 300 to 100,000 years ago. It turns out that all non-African people alive today emerged from a single exodus out of Africa of about 50,000 people, the size of Soldier Field, to give rise to all 6 billion non-Africans that are alive today. And this happened 50,000 to 60,000 years ago. The big question has been, as humans started to emerge into Europe, and Neanderthals died out, why? How did that happen? How did this rich history of conflict between these species happen? Was there direct conflict, genocide? That appears pretty likely. It was direct conflict. Was it simply competition? Was it disease? We don't know, but the big question is, did they interbreed? Are we part Neanderthal? And now the Human Genome Project, and we have solved the Neanderthal genome? The answer is yes. All non-African people people have 1 to 1.5% Neanderthal DNA in us. If you're from Eastern Europe, it's closer to 2 to 2.5% Neanderthal DNA. If you're from Southeast Asia, it's closer to 3 to 3.5%, which is interesting. I'm sorry? So the Bering Strait, yes. This is Native Americans. These would be mostly from that Asian population, closer to 2.5 to 3. Yeah, so these would be in the higher range, absolutely right. So, which is interesting because Neanderthals never lived in Asia.
Right.
They never lived in Southeast Asia. We do think some Neanderthals lived in Central China, actually feeding more on insects than the big game hunters of Europe. So this is the story about 10 to 15 years ago when this exhibit was made, about Neanderthals and us having. Let me tell you some of the cool stuff that we've learned in the last decade. Neanderthals are not the only species that we lived alongside and interbred with. We've recently discovered Denisovans, which are a species of hominid that lived in Central Asia in a cave in Denisova, we discovered. In fact, we found such nicely preserved finger bone and tooth. We're able to solve their genome and realize that Homo sapiens have up to 6% Denisovan DNA. Right. Now, here's what's fascinating. Now, another fascinating thing, most of the genetic information of our genetic diversity is still in Africa. Because such a small group of people give rise to all non-African people. Most of our diversity is still in Africa. And they also have lots of other interbreeding events with other descendants of Homo heidelbergensis who live alongside each other. In fact, when we read our genome, without need for any other comparison, when we read our genome today, we can predict fossils that we haven't discovered because they interbred with us. That doesn't blow your mind, I don't know what will, right? Yeah. We've recently found one that was as recent as 9,000 years ago. So we are interbreeding with different species right up against ancient Sumerian. And this rich history of different, think about class of civilization, class of species that we have no written record of, and how interesting that would be if some of them had survived to present day. Maybe we couldn't interbreed. We have different kinds of Homo sapiens. You know, you have to watch Star Trek to see how that might work out.
No.
So here's an interesting thing. So Homo sapiens are the last ones surviving. Why? We like to think that we're special in some way, that we had some edge on all these other cousins of ours that let us survive while they didn't, except for a little bit of interbreeding. The more we learn, the more we realize it's more accidental than we had anything special in particular. For example, you look at the non-African triad. This is the Homo sapiens, Neanderthals, and the Denisovans. So the Neanderthals had slightly bigger brains than us. You might argue that they had a more homogeneous lifestyle. Only big game, hunters, maybe they couldn't adapt to changes in climate either, right? But Denisovans were by far more advanced than we were technologically. So we found in this cave in Denisova a polished bracelet of jade, a solid piece, finely polished, with holes drilled in it so that leather charms could be tied to it. It's probably by somebody who's very important. And the holes were drilled so precisely, this was clearly a part of a sophisticated tool, a drill in stone. Homo sapiens were 70,000 years away from being able to make anything like that. Denisovans also produced the first bone needles, able to sew clothing. Homo sapiens were far away from being able to do that. So again, I was thinking of us being more advanced of any of these, even the non-African triad, let alone some of the more African type species. Really, it doesn't hold water anymore. Now, when I say interbred with different species, what do I mean? We're usually taught in school, middle school, that different species means they can't interbreed with each other. So what do I mean, right? Well, it's more complicated than that. Sometimes two things can interbreed with each other, they just don't. So, for example, lions and tigers can interbreed with each other. And no one would argue that they're not different species. That you never find them in the same place. They're genetically isolated, so they don't interact with each other. Also, sometimes A can breed with B, and B can breed with C, but A cannot breed with C. So where do you draw these species lines? Again, a little more complicated. There's also some gray area here. So with Neanderthals, we recently found the Neanderthal Y chromosome, which is only found in males, has nothing in common with our Y chromosome. So all of our Neanderthal DNA comes from Neanderthal females mating with human males. The other way around probably didn't work very well. This is a common thing that we see. Like horses and donkeys, you know, there's a problem as to which sex is mating with which. So let me tell this story through a slightly different lens. I've talked about it via skeletons. That's actually very difficult to do to find good specimens. I mentioned we have very few specimens of Homo habilis. But their stone tools are obviously very well preserved. They're already rocks. So we can track one another like that way. So we look at the Homo habilis, those early primitive stone tools, take a rock, break it in half, use what's left over. Very primitive. Then we find what's called the hand axe, a very ubiquitous tool we find all around Eurasia, mostly made by Homo erectus. What's amazing about the hand axe is we find it over the course of over a million years with absolutely no change in design whatsoever. Think about what we've done with the iPhone for 10 years, and these guys couldn't come up with a notch to strap it to a stick. That's it. This is a very basic kind of a design. What's important, even though this is a sophisticated tool, like you and I probably couldn't make hand axes this well without practicing for a very long time. But these guys are making hand axes the way that birds make nests, out of habit. It's just an ingrained technique. They're not thinking abstractly, they're not thinking, well, if I shape it this way, it'll give you a finer point at the end of the egg. It's just an instinct. It's what we do. This is a hunter, and it's a sophisticated instinct. But this is probably one of the reasons that when they emerged into Homo floresiensis from smaller brains, those behaviors were preserved. Because it didn't require capacity. It simply was just nailed in there. It was blueprinted in as that technique. It's not until you get to the age of modern humans. The key is the age of modern humans, not necessarily Homo sapiens. You get those fine flint scrapers, the arrowheads, the fish hooks, the bone needles, all these kind of finer tools. This thing with the hole, it was probably used as a drill to have a moving piece inside of it. As well as some of the more abstract ideas, the fertility statues, the jewelry, the cave art. Now, Neanderthals had jewelry. Obviously, the Denisovans had jewelry. I mentioned this as well. The cave art is often credited to Homo sapiens. Now, a lot of that's because most of the cave art we know is over the last 10,000 years. Homo sapiens were most of the only game in town in the last 10,000 years. But it drove the idea that maybe we were the special storytellers among the non-African triad. But we have just found Neanderthal cave art. So now, it's interesting, it's not cave paintings. It's actually a carving in the side of a wall, which appears to be done by Neanderthals. Hard to put a value judgment on painting versus carving. They're still capable of two-dimensional representations of the animals that they were hunting. It seems to be very similar. So we see again, not really anything special about Homo sapiens. One thing I want to finish with, and then I'll let you guys open up with all the questions you want. We like to imagine, you know, okay, here's how the story has happened. How are we going to evolve in the next 100,000 years? What are we going to look like in the future? How are we evolving today? All things are evolving all the time. Natural selection is constantly behaving even today. This isn't just the past, retrospective history. However, our natural selection is effectively over. Which should sound weird. Why is that the case? Natural selection happens so slowly, and we are evolving by other mechanisms so rapidly, it dwarfs any input from natural selection. We are selecting in many other ways, and changing in many other ways. So like the last naturally selected gene for Homo sapiens appears to be for lactose tolerance. This happened 3 times in Africa and Europe, which is a very basic kind of a change. We already are lactose tolerant as babies. We simply need to let it survive to adulthood. So, very simple change. This happened over the last thousands of years. That's a very slow mechanism. Think about what we're doing over thousands or hundreds or decades of years, right? We're evolving so fast, whether it be through technology, communication, written communication. Now we aren't dependent on a single lifetime by which to learn things. We learn from all the previous lifetimes through communication. Technology. Also, do you guys know that our IQ gets higher every single year? We aren't selecting for smarter people. It's not through natural selection. It's because we evolve thinking tools, and we learn how to learn, and learn how to learn how to learn. And so the IQ has to be recalibrated every single year, because we are getting smarter and smarter and smarter. That has nothing to do with natural selection. That has to do with our ability to communicate and work cooperatively. Obviously technology, but even from a genetic point of view, we have taken control of our natural selection in ways that nature is dwarfed by. So in vitro fertilization, for example, being able to select which gametes are going to survive, sexual selection, cultural selection. But if you haven't heard about it, learn about CRISPR. CRISPR is going to dominate the next few decades of science and research right now. This allows us to manipulate your genome in every cell of your body in a living organism. So we can now write your genome as you live. We can now, clearly the initial therapeutic use, is to edit out some bad genetic defect so that kids can be born without that effect. We can also cure people of that. We're using it to treat cancer, even possibly hair cancer, using a lot of genetic information, and really synthesizing biology and taking charge of our own evolution. It's been a pleasure talking to you. Anybody have any questions about human evolution? Yes?
His brain was bigger than ours. What about neuron density?
Very good question. He said his brain was bigger than ours. What about neuron density? So he's a primate, just like we are, just like all the monkeys. So the primate density and the distribution of the brain is very comparable. We're also very close relatives.
Good
human breed. We're practically the same species. So pretty much the same. Now when it comes to brain size, I'll caveat that. When we look at brain casings, we look at skulls and the gaps between the brain, there's a lot of variation because fossils swell and shrink. So we can look at the average brain size, and the average appears to be slightly larger, but there's so much overlap in size. You're really splitting hairs. And maybe brain size doesn't necessarily mean he's smarter or had more neurons than we did. Maybe he had a swollen brain. Or maybe it just has to do with the swelling of the fossils in the area that we tend to find Neanderthals. So these are very slim kind of things, very hard to tell from fossils. Yeah?
Yeah, I can
just
think of the
problem. Yes. So all non-African people have Neanderthal DNA, 1 to 1.5%. Eastern Europe, 2 to 2.5%. Southeast Asia, 3 to 3.5%. But we also have DNA from other relatives. Denisovans up to 6%.
Somewhere I read that whatever the gene that makes Sherpas or whatever able to withstand high altitudes and efficient was identical to the Denisovan gene, exactly identical.
That is the kind of thing that is going to be difficult to prove. That's going to be demonstrated. That's the kind of thing that you often see scientists give at the end of research talks, because we want to hear them speculate and say all the cool stuff. That's very hard to say with a lot of confidence. Most of the significance of the genes we found appear to be magic, which is interesting, right? They appear to be connected to cancer. Now, caveat there, most of our knowledge of genes comes from cancer research, so that shouldn't be too surprising. We've got a lot of things with cancer. Possibly some that have to do with the immune system. But the point is that most of them are negative genes. So why do we maintain genes that are bad for us? It's because we've interbred with them so recently, evolution hasn't had a chance to weed out the bad genes. So we are just marked with these genes that aren't really compatible with us, and evolution hasn't had a lot of pressure on those genes. So saying that any good genes that allow us to do things are connected to those, they may be true, but it's unlikely that they were selected for. I think you're referring to the Denisovans. This was a finger bone and a tooth. Yeah, he was so well preserved, but that's all you need is just to get enough DNA and you can amplify it. Yeah, you got a question? How do they start to what? Orange, I don't know what you mean by the orange. You're talking about this color? Well, so there's a few things to your question. So when fossils form, they're not made of bone. When we dig up a fossil, that's not bone. We're finding actually minerals from the environment that have crystallized on the surface of the bone and the interior of the bone, replacing the calcium of the bone. So those Sioux fossils, those big chunks, they aren't bone. They're actually big chunks of mostly iron oxide that was found in the minerals in the groundwater. Very slowly crystallizes and displaces the bone. You don't see any bone left. Now, things within a million years, we can now maintain those soft tissues and even extract DNA. DNA is a hard limit of the body.